Knowing God better is our question today. And this immediately raises the question that there's a difference between knowing about God and actually knowing God. In the same way, we can know an awful lot about another person by reading about them or speaking to people who've spoken them, but we can't say we really necessarily know them as a result of that, because knowing God is about having a relationship with him. And it's got this added dimension of deep relationship. And of course, it involves knowing a huge amount about him and having a growing knowledge of him, but it's being able to relate with him one-to-one. And just think about your deepest relationships. We've just been talking about honeymoons and marriage and so on, but you know, all of us have people in our lives who we have a much deeper relationship with, others who we can say we really know them and they really know us. And just reflect with me a little bit on the quality of those relationships. What makes those relationships special or different? What is different about those relationships that doesn't apply to the whole host of acquaintances we have, or people we might know about or just met once or twice? And just to think about some of those things, I think one of them is quality time together. We've just been talking about honeymoons and quality time together. And of course, for me, my closest, deepest human relationship I have is with my wife. You know, we've been married for 38 years, but it's built not just on going through many, many experiences together, but spending quality time, lots of time together, just talking. And it involves the building of trust in a relationship, involves self-disclosure. You know, when we say to someone, I'm going to tell you now, I've never told anyone before. And we think about our friendships in terms of concentric relationships. You know, your closest circle are people who know things about you and you know things about them that the vast majority of people do not. And we have these layers of intimacy, don't we? That there are some people we'd never tell anything really important to, because there's not the trust there to be able to sustain that degree of self-disclosure. So it's about self-disclosure, openness, honesty, and mutual understanding. We'd say no holds barred. There's no ifs or buts in what we share together. And knowing a person means not just knowing their life story, which you might read in a book or a biography or hear from someone else, and their abilities that they have, perhaps the things that they've achieved, but also a real knowledge of their character, what they are like in different situations. And deep relationships are built through trust, faithfulness, loyalty over a long period of time that grows. And often our deepest relationships are those where there's some shared experience or activities with a common goal, being on a task together. Now, I was at medical school a long, long time ago, but still my medical school friends are still among my very closest of friends this many years later, even as I'm approaching retirement, because we went through so many things together, not just 6 years of medical school, but medical training with all its stresses, but so much time spent together and leisure time on holidays and growing up as each one went through the difficult experiences that life has to offer. And you know, you really remember very much the people who were there for you at the most difficult times that we come across. Remember, you know, for us, the loss of a baby, loss of our fourth child, or the loss of my best friend who was taken very, very young, or difficult situations that you've been through, perhaps at work or in ministry. Mutually given gifts, offering service to one another, speaking well of each other to others, the deep friendships and relationships are those people who, even in company where others are running them down, you will stand up for them because you've got something very deeply invested in the relationship. So think about this in terms of how it relates to our relationship with God. Which of these characteristics are true of our relationship with God? Now, of course, the main difference is that God is so many orders of magnitude greater than any human being. He's our creator and sustainer. He knows everything about us. And of course, he's absolutely morally perfect as well. But a lot of what we just talked about relates, I think, equally well to our relationship with God, built over a long time through difficult situations in an atmosphere of trust where we're sharing the deepest things about ourselves with him and coming to know him similarly. You think of some biblical characters who had a deep relationship with God. You think of some who springs to mind for what we know from the Bible in terms of what they write.
Abraham.
Yeah. And with Abraham, what was that relationship forged through?
Sorry, the question is?
So how was that relationship built up with Abraham?
Yeah. Because Abraham trusted God and God showed things to Abraham that he didn't show to other people, so that Abraham was called a friend of God.
Yeah. So God's revelation was right at the key of the point of it, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Excuse me. Anyone else that springs to mind?
David.
Yeah, David. And we have many of the Psalms, don't we, to know. And we see in the Psalms, David's deep, deep wrestlings with God in all sorts of circumstances. Sometimes he's absolutely full of praise. Sometimes he's arguing with God. Sometimes he's in deep despair. But there's never anything hidden with David, or he's confessing his sin, you know. Who else? Think of people who spoke to God, particularly who spoke to God very openly and honestly, sometimes angrily.
Moses.
Yeah. He had a few arguments, didn't he? And perhaps a lot of the prophets, aren't they? You think about, you read the book of Jeremiah, see some of the arguments that Jeremiah has with God. There's no stiff formality with Jeremiah, or think of Job and so much of what he says to the Lord. So we've got lots of good examples in the Bible. And J.I. Packer, who is the author of the book called Knowing God, which I think is a wonderful book to read. I was introduced to it when I was a medical student, and I'd still say it's one of the most formative books I'd ever read. And he talks about life being like people traveling along a path through over hills and through valleys and rivers and all sorts of obstacles along the way. And he says there are two kinds of people in the world. There are those who are sitting on a balcony looking over the path, but they're not walking along it. And then there are those who are actually traveling along the path. And the questions they ask are different kinds of questions. So the person on the balcony might ask, you know, is the path real? Is it leading anywhere? Who are the people who are on it? And so on. But the person walking on the path is asking questions like, how can I get over this fence or under or over this next hill, or what lies around the next corner? How am I going to cope with what I'm coming? And the Bible is a book not for balconiers, for people who sit on a balcony, but for travelers who are walking along life's way in partnership with God. And so, you know, I'd suggest to you that knowing God is much more like a reckless love affair than a formal agreement. It's where both partners are very open and honest with each other, and where it's safe to express all kinds of emotions, that God doesn't if we only ever approach God in formal moments at set times, then I think it's evidence of not a very good deep relationship. Whereas knowing God is about a continual moment by moment walk with him, where he's involved and never far from our thoughts, involved in everything that we do. Now, how is knowing God possible? If God is so utterly mega in every respect, and he lives, we're told, in unapproachable light, how can we ever get to know him or approach him? And of course, the answer is that we can only do that if he chooses to reveal himself to us. And so we just talked about Abraham being the friend of God, because God revealed himself to Abraham. And Hebrews 1:1-4 tells us that, you know, no one's ever seen God, but God has made himself known through the prophets, to whom he spoke with our fathers, and most perfectly through Jesus Christ, his incarnate son, who carries the very image of God. And so God reveals himself primarily through Jesus Christ, who is God in the flesh, fully God and fully man. And those scriptures there just reminding us that there's no other way to God than through Jesus Christ. John 14:6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Or 1 Timothy 2:5, there's one God and one mediator between God and man, the man Jesus Christ. And so Jesus is our path to God. And also, of course, the scriptures, which Christ came to fulfill and generated through the Holy Spirit, as we've looked at in other sessions. Paul tells Timothy to be immersed in the scriptures because of their power in every area of his life. Or Joshua is told, this book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth, but you'll meditate on it every day, that you might be careful to do according to everything that's written in it. So he speaks to us through Jesus Christ and through the scripture, but most perfectly through Jesus Christ, who of course has walked the earth like us, and so understands everything that is involved in being a human being, and the difficulties and temptations we face, and the frailties we deal with. And so our first point of approach has to be the Bible itself, and of course the whole of the scripture, because Paul, writing to Timothy, was talking about the Old Testament, because the New Testament had not been written. And it's just a reminder that Jesus put his stamp of authority on the Old Testament, so he treated its historical narratives as straightforward records of fact. The things that a lot of people doubt, like the story of Noah and the great flood, or the story of Abel, Adam and Eve's son. Jesus talks about Abel as a historical figure. He talks about Jonah spending 3 days in the belly of a fish. So Jesus put his stamp of authority by treating its narratives as a straightforward fact, but he also repeatedly quoted it, the scriptures, as the final court of appeal and debates. You know, it is written, this. Remember Jesus in the wilderness, Matthew 4:1-11, when tempted by the devil, and he answers him with three quotes from the book of Deuteronomy. It is written. Da, 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 da. And then he believed its prophecies were fulfilled in him. And on the road to Emmaus, Luke 24, we see him describing in great detail and taking them through the whole of the Old Testament, these two people, to show that he was the Messiah and that he'd fulfilled every prophecy that was talked about. And then, of course, perhaps most importantly, he obeyed its ethical teaching, that he never sinned, he always walked in obedience to the commands that God had given. So he put a stamp of authority on the Old Testament, but he also commissioned the writing of the New Testament. Think about this, that first of all, the apostles were eyewitnesses of everything he said and did, and all of the books of the New Testament were written either by apostles or by people who were in the apostolic community and very close to them, like the brothers of Jesus, James and Jude, who each wrote a book. And he personally commissioned them as well. He gave them the Great Commission. He said what they bound on earth would be bound in heaven. And he also then gave them the Holy Spirit. In John 14:25-26, he says, "After I go, I'll send the Holy Spirit, and he'll teach you all things and remind you of everything I said. Take what is mine and make it known to them. Guide them into all truth." And so not only were these people the eyewitnesses and knew Christ, really knew him and walked with him for 3 years at least, we know, but they were also commissioned by him, trusted by him, and given the Holy Spirit so that they would get it right as well. And so if we're following Christ, we have to have the same attitude he has about both the Old Testament, which was written then, and the New Testament, which he commissioned. Now, think about the attributes and qualities of God. He is the creator of the whole universe. He's the sustainer and sovereign over it. So he is not just creating it and outside the mechanism of it, but he's actually in the mechanism, making everything happen, making the grass grow, the sun shine, the earth turn on its axis. He raises up kings and brings them down and directs the history of the world. And he's also its Lord and Master, its judge, because everyone will be before the throne of judgment. And he owns the universe and everything in it, including us, of course, as well. And God is revealed as existing in three persons: the Father, who we do not see, but who sends the Son, who bears the very stamp of his nature and enters this world as a human being, and then the Holy Spirit, who is given to us to live within us. And we use these big words that he's all powerful, he's all knowing, he's present everywhere, and he's utterly benevolent and kind and loving in everything that he does, gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, and rich in love. And of course, the most beautifully expressed in the fact that Jesus died in our place for our sin, and he thereby became not only our creator but our savior and our deliverer. So these are the things about God. And of course, so God speaks very powerfully through the scriptures, but of course God can speak to us in other ways as well. God's not limited in the way that he speaks to us, but all of the other ways in which he speaks to us need to be tested and judged against the scripture in case that we are not deceived. So we know that God speaks to us through the Holy Spirit, that he gives us the Spirit to prompt us, to remind us of the things that he taught us, to give us the power to obey him, to reassure us that we're the children of God. And there's some references to that. Of course, a lot of that comes from John 14-16, where Jesus is talking about the Holy Spirit to his disciples. And he gives us, of course, prayer. We can ask him for direction, but again, it should always point us back to his word. And God can speak to us also through the wise counsel of others, from older brothers or sisters in the Lord. There's a lot in the Bible about the wisdom of people who walk with God, to, as Paul said, imitate me like I imitate Christ, that we can learn a lot from people who are a little bit further along the path than we are, or even those who are walking with us, and even those who are very young Christians, God can speak to us through them. And then, of course, there's conscience as well, that God gives us this divine attribute of conscience, which makes us feel guilty when we do something wrong, or prompts us along the right way, makes us feel good and affirmed when we're walking in the right path. But of course, conscience itself, even though it's God-given, itself needs to be tested against scripture, because conscience can become blunted through disbelief and habitual sins, if you go against your conscience long enough, it will become blunted and not be triggering when it should do. And in the same way, conscience can be uneducated, so that it doesn't make us feel guilty when we're doing things that are wrong, or alternatively, it can be oversensitive, so making us feel anxious or guilty when in fact we're doing nothing wrong at all. So the point is that God speaks in many ways, but all of these things need to be tested. Sometimes God opens and closes doors. He guides through circumstances. Sometimes he'll speak to us in different ways. We know that God speaks and can speak in dreams and visions and words and prophecies and all of these ways, but and does in both Old and New Testaments. And we should be open to these possibilities, but everything needs to be tested against Scripture, because there is such a thing as a false prophecy as well. you think of Paul as he was going around Asia Minor when one day he has a dream of the man from Thessalonia who says, come over here. He has a revelation or a vision which he follows. And we know that God can speak in these ways. So the thrust of what I'm saying to you here is that the Old and New Testaments of the Bible are where primarily we should go, but we should be open to God speaking in other ways, but they all need to be tested against Scripture. So knowing God is both beginning and a process. So the knowledge of God is something that is given to every believer. Jesus talks about knowing God as eternal life. And so just as a little tiny baby can recognize and know and love its father and its mother, so there's a beginning. Of course, there's a time when a baby isn't even aware of its own existence or the existence of its parents, but it becomes aware that these are two special people. But then through the whole of childhood and life, that knowledge is growing and growing with more time and exposure. And so in the same way, we can say that we have known God or known by God right from the beginning when we become his followers. We know him then, but we then come on to know him more deeply. Knowing God is the greatest thing in all the world, Philippians 3:8. The greatest ambition and achievement and the greatest passion. Philippians 3, 10 and 11. I'll just read these verses out. They're so great. I want to know Christ, says Paul, and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of suffering and his sharing in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow to attain to the resurrection from the dead. And knowing God is only possible by revelation through God's Spirit. It's got to be based on God revealing himself to us. Now, just to remind us just of some of the important foundations of knowing who we are in Christ and being properly rooted in this. So Ephesians chapter 1 is a wonderful thing to read, because it tells us that everything has got that God has done from us or for us, that he has blessed us by choosing us before our creation, by predestining us to be conformed to the image of his son, by adopting us into his family, by saving us, by including us, and by marking us. And that when we come to him in repentance and faith, we pass from death to life, and that we're utterly secure in that future. John 5:24, these great verses, let me just read it out. I tell you the truth, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be condemned. He's crossed over from death to life. And so when we become believers, we are utterly secure in him, not because we hold on to him, not because we are faithful, but because he is absolutely faithful and that nothing can ever take us from him. So as Romans 8 reminds us, nothing can separate us from the love of God, which is ours in Christ. Or John 10:28, nothing can pluck us out of his hand. Or Hebrews 13:5-6, I will never leave you nor forsake you, he says. So knowing that, as we were saying before, strong relationships are based on trust. And the root of our knowledge of God is that we can absolutely trust him because he's absolutely trustworthy. He always speaks the truth. He never lies, and he has the power to save us. And then the reminder that we have new natures when we become believers. If anyone is in Christ, 2 Corinthians 5:7, he's a new creation. Talked about in the prophecies of Jeremiah, that when we become believers, God gives us a new nature whereby where it's possible for us to walk in obedience to him and to do what we could never do before. And in addition to that, he gives us the Holy Spirit to live within us, to remind us of what he said, to empower us, to convict us of sin, and to walk with us. So this knowing who we are in Christ, what he's done through saving us, and the position that we're in now is an incredible ground for security going forward. And then to know that every day of our lives has been preordained by God. Psalm 139 is that Psalm of David's where he looks right back to when he was born in the womb, right up to the present day, and says that every day of my life was planned before any one of them came to be. And we know that his plans for us are good. I came to give you a future and a hope, he says to Jeremiah. I don't know about you, but that I just find that so wonderfully liberating and strengthening, and gives you such security to know that every day you wake up, that God has planned what you would be doing today. You know, God planned that we'd all be sitting here now thinking about how to know him, and he planned it before the beginning of time. And to put it another way, we're saved by grace through his unmerited gift, through faith, through trusting obedience in him, and with good works prepared for us to do. Ephesians 2 talks about the good works that God prepared for us beforehand that we might walk in them. So not only has he preordained our day, but he's created things for us to do as well. And he's given each one of us specific gifts in the body of Christ and a role to play, gifts that we need to discover and develop, gifts that he's provided especially for us in order that we can play the role that he's called us to. And he's working out all the situations that we face for our good, even the mistakes we make, even the wrong decisions we make, even the times we messed up, God is working in these for our good. And he's gracious and forgiving and is bigger than our wrong decisions, because he removes our sin from us as far as the east is from the west, we're told in Psalm 103. And of course, when Jesus shed his blood on the cross, it wasn't just for all the sins that we had committed up until that point, but for every day of our lives in the present and going into the future as well. And when we stand before him on that day, he will see us clothed with the righteousness of Christ. And we will know that we have been utterly forgiven because of what he's done. So these are some of the wonderful truths, I think, that are so important to keep reminding ourselves of to be able to walk with him. And then knowing God means obeying God. And this is a really important thing to grasp, following Jesus involves obeying his commands. Now, do you remember the man came to ask Jesus, what's the most important commandment in the law? And the man said, you know, what Jesus answered, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And he said, there's a second one like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. So he took these out of Deuteronomy chapter 5 and Leviticus 19, the Old Testament. But these two, he said, summed up everything. On these two hang all the law and the prophets, he says in Matthew 22. And the life in Christ is not a life free from obligation, because we're asked to walk in the same way that Jesus did and to fulfill the law of Christ. The law of Christ is an interesting expression. It comes up in both John 13 and in 1 Corinthians 9:21, and in Galatians 6:2, where he talks about bearing one another's burdens is fulfilling the law of Christ. And so the whole ethical demands of Scripture boil down to loving God with all one's heart, soul, mind, and strength, and one's neighbor as oneself. In the same way, whoever does not obey God's commands does not know God. So it's not that we earn our salvation through obeying his commands, but it is that an obedient life is evidence of a real relationship with him. In the same way, you would say, you know, if with a married couple, you can judge by the way they treat each other whether they really love one another. You could tell in a deep friendship if the friendship is genuine by the way people behave toward each other in that. And this is a really important thing, that obeying God is the key to more revelation from God. It's almost like you think a person walking along a path and they get an instruction to go to the next point. And then at the next point, there's another message, and that tells them to go to somewhere else. They go there and they get the next message, and then they're told to go somewhere else and they get there and they get the next message. And the Christian life is in many ways like this, that through obeying God and being faithful to him day by day, we then set ourselves on a path whereby he's revealing more and more and more to us as we go along. So that each step of obedience puts us into a place where we're going to hear his guidance and leading for the next steps in our life. Now, these scriptures, let's just look at a couple of them. John 7:17. And John says, Jesus says in John 7:16, Jesus answered, my teaching is not my own. It comes from him who sent me. And listen to this. If anyone chooses to do God's will, he will find out whether my teaching comes from God or whether I speak on my own. If anyone chooses to do God's will, he finds out whether my teaching comes from God or whether I speak on my own. So the path to a deeper knowledge of God is obedience. And I remember when I was a student at school, and my friend and I were wrestling with this question, you know, how do we know God? And we asked this guy from the Navigators, who was helping to support us and teach us, and he said, let me go away and think about that question. And we knew he'd come back with a verse the next day, as they always do. And the verse he came back with is the second one here, John 14:21, where Jesus says, whoever has my commands and obeys them, he is the one who loves me. And he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I too will love him and show myself to him. Okay, so whoever has my commands and obeys them, I too will love him and show myself to him. And so God promises to reveal more and more of himself to us as we walk in obedience to him. So there's an inextricable link in the Bible between knowing God, between loving God, and between obeying God. The three are all wrapped up together. If you love me, you'll obey my commandments. if you obey me, then I'll reveal more of myself to him. Here it is. And then we see this in Jeremiah 22:16, where God says that serving the poor and needy and loving our brothers and sisters is actually what it is to know him. Yeah. And so it's not just an intellectual belief or even even a deep knowledge of it. It's actually walking in his ways that tells us that we know him, and it's the key to knowing him more deeply. So there we are. Here's a few book recommendations. These are just things. I mean, there's so much on this, isn't there? But these things I've found really helpful personally. Knowing God is a classic, written back in the 1970s, but just so rich. Augustine's Confessions, The Pursuit of God by A.W. Tozer. And I do love the Pilgrim's Progress, the second most translated book in the whole world, apart from the Bible, that's available in more languages and has been read by more people. And it's a beautiful picture of the Christian life, because it's this man walking a journey through all the challenges that life brings and coming to know and trust God more and more through it. And if you particularly like the genre of the Pilgrim's Progress, then another book that's not nearly as well known, but I think is an equal blessing, at least was for me, is a book with a very similar name, The Pilgrim's Regress, The Pilgrim's Regress by C.S. Lewis. And as in Pilgrim's Progress, Christian travels through lots of different lands, meeting people who represent different vices and virtues. In The Pilgrim's Regress, the character who's called John travels through lands and meets people who represent different philosophies and belief systems, and he interacts with them. But on the same way, he's on the journey to heaven.